I'm gonna be surviving 100 days in a jungle-only world, but not just any old Minecraft jungle. This jungle has tigers, gorillas, crocodiles, and much, much more. Can I master this overgrown paradise, or will I become yet another foolish adventurer? Here I was in the endless jungle. Like any Minecraft player, my first step was to smash the nearest tree to pieces. I made a crafting table as well as a wooden pickaxe and began exploring. After getting my legs wet, I got to work collecting some stone in order to upgrade my tools. Wood is for peasants, stone is for slightly more well-off peasants. And yes, I definitely meant to make two stone pickaxes, that's why I paused for several seconds wondering how I graduated from preschool. I looked at some of the new weapons available and noticed this little green parrot nearby. I found some green onion seeds, but he wasn't impressed. They're green onion seeds and you're a green parrot. Eat the seeds! I met a happy creeper couple and they didn't stay happy for long. I collected some coal and then continued pushing through the undergrowth. The wildlife in this place was absolutely stunning, and I spent a while just taking it all in. On the less stunning side, I spotted a piranha, and he seemed to be challenging me. I jumped down, missed, and he bit me. I stumbled upon a ravine, and of course leapt straight into the puddle of ankle-deep water at the bottom. I got to work collecting some iron and coal, which I used to craft myself an iron chestplate. Now you might see this stingray here, and think, "Oh, what a cute little stingray." No, these things will poison you if you get too close. I made a crude wooden shield, which I upgraded to a stone shield, and my favorite thing about these is that you can bonk enemies over the head with them. But talking of my favorite things, let me tell you about today's sponsor, Clash Royale. Clash Royale is a real-time multiplayer game with dozens of unique troops, spells, and defenses. Clash Royale is also the only game where you can put a guy in a barrel, throw him at an enemy wizard, and watch them duke it out. And then if you lose, just spawn a P.E.K.K.A. and watch it wipe that wizard off the face of the earth. I've been playing for 6 years now, and the feeling of destroying your opponent's towers and taking the win never gets old. As you gain trophies and progress through the arenas, you'll unlock more and more new cards, with my favorite being the Rocket. I'm an expert, what can I say? You can play against your friends, or with your friends in real-time 2v2 battles, or duke it out in 1v1s to climb the prestigious trophy road. Maybe you could be the next top player. Download the game for free using the link in the pinned comment. And now let's get back to the video. Come on, zombie. Oh, that's too bad. Try again, try again. Oh, you'll get me next time. I'm laughing, but I've probably given him severe head trauma. Karma was immediately served to me on a silver platter when I came across this skeleton spawner. I took heavy damage within seconds and it wasn't looking good. These two skeletons started fighting and I thought it would buy me time to heal up, but one of them completely folded. As I fled, I crashed to the ground, leaving me with just half a heart left. I scrambled to block myself in, and by some miracle, managed to prevent the skeleton from dealing the final blow. Now, what I should have done in this situation was learn from my mistakes, back off, and come back when I had better gear. What I actually did was start digging a tunnel underneath the mob spawner so that I could steal all the loot. I had zero food left, so I really couldn't afford to mess this up. Unfortunately, that's exactly what I did, but somehow I got everything under control. Before I knew it, I was staring one of the chests right in the face, and all the pain was worth it. You know what? This is fine. There's gonna be better stuff in the other chest. I'm starting to wish the skeleton had actually taken me out earlier. It wasn't all bad though. I did now have some food that wouldn't make a health inspector keel over. After ascending to the top of the ravine, I found a small ruin. I dug around in the hopes of finding some buried treasure, but all it had to offer was soul sand. But then I discovered a ruin that did have some treasure, and this stuff was genuinely really useful. I then realized this whole building was made of silverfish stone and promptly ran away. You might call that cowardly, and so would I, but I didn't want to stick around and watch the building turn into a writhing mass of silver insects. Don't worry though, there's plenty of that further down the line. Before long, I found yet another ruin, and this one was the best one yet. I found some protection one chain boots, and yes! Spruce wood is by far my favorite wood, and seeing as it doesn't spawn naturally in the jungle, I had just hit the jackpot. There were also some lapis blocks on top and a wild onion patch outside. I'm I'm not sure what the consensus is on eating raw onion, but you gotta do what you gotta do. I startled a couple of butterflies, probably because they saw pieces of raw onion on my hands, and then jumped into this hole. It had tons of iron and coal deposits, as well as a very angry and now very dead skeleton. Wait, aren't skeletons already dead because they're skeletons? Anyway, I crafted myself a full suit of iron armor and started mining down in the hopes of finding a cave. Oh look! A cave! There were a fair few monsters inside, so I jumped down and let nature run its course. I'm not gonna get a disease from these, am I? This spider didn't fight back at all, so I thought about my actions for a second, and then killed him anyway. I kept exploring, dropping into this tunnel, and then this happened. I already know I'm getting a million comments on this video saying it's fake, especially since it was an 8 vein. I made a diamond pickaxe, and by using the leather I got from the ruin earlier, made a handle, and used said handle to make a diamond saber. It does extra damage to enemies without a chestplate, which is about 95% of them, so we'll almost always be getting the bonus. I'd also found a book in that previous ruin, which meant after mining up some obsidian, I could craft an enchantment table. This was amazing, as not only could I enchant my iron armor with protection 1, effectively giving it the same defense level as diamond, I was also able to snag fire aspect on my sword. I was feeling great with all my new gear and continued through the cave. I could hear this weird clicking sound. What is that? What is that? Just kill it, just kill it, just kill it. Get off my screen right now. Not only do these hearts represent my health, they also represent my mental state. After some deep breaths, and by that I mean a lot of deep breaths, I was ready to continue adventuring. I had somehow amassed a stack of iron, which I planned to use for an anvil and some extra tools. I needed to wait for it all to smelt, so in the meantime, I proceeded to beat up every monster I could lay my hands on. However, the iron was still nowhere near done, so I grabbed it and started heading to the surface. When I finally reached it, night had already fallen, so I instantly started heading for the treetops. It's extremely dangerous down on the forest floor, as monsters, especially creepers, can hide in amongst all the leaves and vines. I then replaced my stone shield with an iron-plated one. It's really bulky, so I decided not to use it unless I was in danger. Like right now, where I'm fighting the skeleton. I had a look around for a good-looking tree and settled on this one. When you're making a base in the jungle, you're pretty much legally obligated to build a treehouse. My inventory was stuffed to the brim, and it felt great to finally offload all of my possessions into a chest. Bear in mind, what I'm building right now is only a temporary base for me to find my feet. Before I can build something cooler, I need better tools, and more importantly, a more stable food source than scavenging for melons. I added a fence around the edge of the treehouse because otherwise I would definitely slip off and break both my legs. I then did something very out of character. I organized all my stuff on day 4. Usually I leave it till about day 30, when it's gotten so out of hand that I have to organize it. I'd spotted a few sheep when I'd emerged from the caves and really wanted a bed, so I began searching for them. There were a ton of mobs around, including this skeleton with his ginormous head. This sheep actually gave me 3 wool, which made my life a lot easier. On my way back to the treehouse, I found a roach, and naturally chased it down in order to wipe it off the face of the earth. I got a little bit lost on my way back, and by that I mean I literally found a gorilla, but I used my good old tree hopping method to find the base. This creeper was lurking at the bottom, so I was gonna need to evict him. The next day, I crafted an iron hoe as well as a pile of torches. Where are you, creeper? I'm not mad or anything. I just want to talk. Get off my land. As I mentioned earlier, food was becoming a growing problem, so I began clearing an area for a farm. If you've ever tried to build something in the jungle, you know just how time consuming this is. There's just so many leaves. I ate a banana, which gave me +1000 energy, and started building a wall around the area, Luke the Notable style. Normally, I would never bother doing this, but I wanted to ensure I wasn't snuck up on in the middle of the night. It also really helped to visualize where my territory ends and the jungle begins. Ooh, abandoned property I can ransack later. I also dyed my bed red as an homage to the OG. If you don't get it, then you should build a time machine and restart your entire childhood. I began planting every seed I could get my hands on. Pineapple, tomatoes, cabbages, wheat, Why did I only just get the advancement for planting seeds? I needed to set up an infinite water source, so I visited a nearby pond. After giving the crops the gift of hydration, I began pumping them with steroids. Anyway, I started looking at all the different foods I could potentially make. I'd say this one's my favorite. Seeing as I had a small area to work with now, I decided I might as well raise some animals. And by animals, I mean only sheep. They were the only ones available. It was pretty frustrating taking them through the undergrowth, but eventually the suffering paid off. I hope they like their new home, because they're stuck here forever. I thought the base could do with a little bit of expansion, so I added this lookout area on top. I bred the sheep again and harvested some rhubarb. I bet I could cook something nice with this. I'm missing key ingredients for all of these. I did a completely pointless water bucket from the treehouse and set out towards the ruin. My mind raced with all the loot it could have. Emeralds, gold, diamonds. Who knew what awaited us? It's literally the spruce sapling ruin from a few days ago. How did I not realize? Seeing as west was the direction I'd unknowingly come from, I decided to head east instead. I'd spent quite a few days in the same place, so I really just wanted to go out and explore and also work on my water bucket skills. I discovered a pillager outpost immediately, as well as a well. We're actually going to keep a running tally of these because I find way too many of them throughout this video. I equipped my shield and approached the outpost ready for a fight. It started off well, but the crossbow damage quickly started to add up. I retreated into the trees and realized I could just shimmy over to the chest at the top instead of fighting for it. In typical pillager outpost fashion, the loot was mediocre. Then this genius decided to climb up into the trees to fight me, and he got exactly what he deserved. All the pillagers seemed pretty mad that I just horrifically pushed one of their men off a 20-foot drop, and I fled the scene. I'd managed to grab a couple of their hay bales, which I used to make a moderate supply of bread. I wasn't done with my exploring yet and pushed onward. I found this cute little songbird and then stumbled across a jungle variant of the desert temple. A Jungezert temple? A Dizungle temple? You know what? That's not important. I dug down, expecting the usual TNT chamber, and was horrified to find that the entire thing was made of several layers of silverfish stone. The more I killed, the more spawned in to take their place. I could have jumped down and tried to outdamage them, but I had no idea if there was a TNT trap at the bottom, nor did I know if I could even win the fight. Don't worry though, I'm not giving up on this place. I already had an idea cooking up about how I was gonna wipe every single last silverfish out. But first, it's nap time. Now that nap time was over, I made my way over to the hole I found earlier. I think you can guess what my plan is here. I'm gonna use the lava to make obsidian, use that obsidian to make a nether portal, go to the nether, fetch back a ghast, transport it to the temple, and use the ghast to blow up the silverfish. It's quite simple, really. Of course, I'm kidding. The lava fried the silverfish, and the plan was working spectacularly. Until I got jump scared and accidentally dropped my saber. The more I tried to bat the silverfish away, the more would spawn in. I couldn't jump in and face them head on, or the entire chamber would crumble, and I couldn't pour lava on them or I'd lose my saber. I tried using a fishing rod to yank it back up to me, which actually does work in Java Edition, but the silverfish were directly on top of the saber. I decided my best bet was to dig a safety tunnel. I dropped down, grabbed the saber, and blocked off the tunnel. From there, I could pour lava over the top and exterminate all the silverfish. Now that the crisis had been averted, I could get things back on track. Before long, the fabled chest room was finally in sight. Surprisingly, it didn't have the classic pressure plate trap, although I guess that makes sense considering how easy it would be for a silverfish to trigger it and blow up all the loot. Talking of loot, it was solid. It wasn't an insane pile of riches or anything, but it definitely wasn't bad. I'd say the pain and suffering was worth it for 4 diamonds. I'd brought my bed with me, so I ended up sleeping inside the temple, which, considering how ancient it is, probably has a million different bugs inhabiting all the cracked stone bricks. Instead of heading back home, I decided to keep heading east. I was going in more or less a straight line, so it wouldn't be difficult to find my way back. I also probably did more water buckets in this one video than all my others combined. I found another well, bringing our count up to 2, with an anthill nearby. Unfortunately, the well didn't have any emerald ore like the last one, so it was a stupid well. Also, the terrain generation here was, It was really something. I didn't have any specific limit for when I'd turn back. It was more I'd turn back after finding and looting a cool new structure. I found a ruin with more of these guys, Yay. I've actually done 4 previous attempts at Jungle Only 100 Days, and in one of them, I died to Silverfish on day 2, which is why I was so cautious of the temple earlier. To top things off, the ruin didn't even have a chest. Or maybe it did and I'm just dumb, but judging by how much I destroyed, I'm pretty confident in saying it didn't have a chest. I continued my journey through the tangled undergrowth and found a good old-fashioned jungle temple. And a well. But at least this time it was a good well. I can't tell you how good it felt to be inside a temple and not have to worry about silverfish. I made my way through the extremely low quality traps and was rewarded with equally low quality loot. I decided to try and do the lever puzzle legit, and after about a minute of flicking the levers randomly, I actually managed to get inside. The reward was... it was really something. This sightseeing couple got lost, so I showed them the way to the afterlife. There's a lot of trekking through the jungle with not a lot of potential commentary. I mean, it's just all leaves. And very high definition water, which my PC was really happy about. I discovered a forest fire in the making and did absolutely nothing to help. Instead, I decided to see how fast I could break this golden hoe. The answer is about 2.5 seconds. There was a gold block which I definitely wanted, so I carefully surrounded it with dirt and... well, I'm uninstalling the game. It was the only one that spawned too, so I wasn't able to get a spare to make up for it. I spotted easily the most complete ruin so far, and as a bonus, it didn't house a single silverfish. The loot was alright. I'll take an enchanted fishing rod, plus the golden apple will come in handy. A fly was hovering nearby, so naturally I sliced it in half. I tried taming this ocelot with fish for old time's sake, but of course it didn't work. Yippee, another well. If I find another one of these in the next few minutes, I'm gonna eat at Arby's. Oh, please, no. No, no, I was joking, no. I started off day 11 by restocking on melons. Take that, zombie. Oh, you have a wife and kids. I think I should leave now. I was a considerable distance away from home, but I still didn't want to turn back yet. I yearn for adventure. Actually, it's because I have a ton of chores to do back at the base and I kind of don't want to do them. I found another ruined portal and finally had the chance to redeem myself. Sometimes you just have to look up at the sky and ask, why me? Thankfully, there was an extra gold block, and at last things went in my favor. I spotted a floating island up in the distance, Terraria style, and I have to explore that. I scaled the closest tall tree, and from there I could pillar up. There was a small ruin with a chest, and... ooh, that is what I like to see. I could hear groans coming from below the floorboards, and sure enough, there was a concealed zombie spawner. Only one zombie had actually managed to materialize, so I just jumped down and deleted him. There weren't any chests, but there were some very nice piles of iron and gold blocks. I had the urge to jump off and land a water bucket, but even I'm not dumb enough to risk that. Instead, I took the easy way down, and still broke my ankle. There was a ruined portal right in the middle of this lake, so this time there was no forest fire. Some piranhas tried nibbling on my toes, but they got what they deserved. This portal generation is honestly super cool, and I would have loved to make it into a proper island build. But I have chores to neglect and structures to ransack. Night was beginning to fall, and I really should have slept, but instead I continued on. Like I really should have slept. I wised up and stuck to the treetops before becoming even wiser upper and just going to bed. I began my morning, as everyone does, by getting set on fire. I found yet another silverfish ruin. I searched fruitlessly for a chest, and after stopping to kill a silverfish, I made my way out. It was another of those days where I just do a lot of running and jumping and whatnot. I found a melon patch which made me go from a measly 22 melons to a mighty 64. That sounds cool until you remember that melons are one of the worst food sources in the game. I came across a grove with these little guys hanging out, and they were adorable. I should probably know what they're actually called, but I lack basic thinking functions, so someone please let me know in the comments. Time ticked on, and I still hadn't found a new structure yet, but I had an idea. What if I climbed a tall tree and then increased my render distance a little? The most obvious thing was the floating island to my right, but more importantly, I could just about spot a village. I started bridging over to the island and nearly suffered a horrible fall, but I managed to save myself. I found another boatload of golden apples, as well as a backup diamond chestplate. I then broke into the hidden chamber, wiped out a family of zombies, and stole all their money. Cause I'm the good guy, remember? I then began heading through the jungle in what I hoped was the direction of the village. Surprisingly enough, I actually managed to find it. Ah, this is great. What is that? Get it off, get it off! I've never read a more accurate advancement in my entire life. This mod pack adds guards to villages, although they didn't really seem to care about me blatantly robbing the civilians. You hear that, Taisha? All your stuff is mine now. Oh, hi, officer. Yeah, everything's fine. Oh my days, the gorillas are adorable. The village had a blacksmith, and the loot was genuinely awful. I mean, my expectations were low, but man, we're scraping the bottom of the barrel here. I tried out this quarterstaff, but it was nothing special, and I ended up throwing it away. I need a place to stay for the night. Thanks, Josephina. Is she asleep or awake? I can't tell. I awoke to Josephina yelling at me about breaking into her house. I asked if I could bounce a ping pong ball off her forehead, and that was the final straw. Before she returned with the guards, I made my escape. And once I was 10 meters down the path, I got right back to my life of crime. This house is full of dirt. How do you guys live like this? I'm gonna steal your stuff, but I've gotta clean your house up, dude. I wanted to craft a backpack, which requires leather. And since I'd spotted a cow pen last night, I knew this was a golden opportunity. Unfortunately, when I visited the cow pen, one of the cows had escaped, so I was gonna need to track him down. Sup, Dee Dee, mind if I take your stuff? Thanks, Dee Dee. Cow police, you have the right to remain silent. A pair of villagers were having a romantic moment in the cow pen, so I kicked them out. Go on, there's a time and place, people. There was a cat that had somehow ended up in the pen, and I knew I had to make her my friend. It was time to break in my enchanted fishing rod. I also found the most cursed thing ever, a skinny iron golem. He looks like he dropped iron nuggets instead of ingots. Taming the cat was not an easy task, mainly because she did a lot of running away and not a lot of staying still. I persevered though, and eventually she was mine. I decided to name her Zip, seeing as she loves to run. I didn't want to keep breaking into Josephina's house, so instead I commandeered the blacksmith. By the way, Zip is the cutest cat to ever exist. I bred the cows and fed the little ones so that they'll grow up big and strong, and hopefully drop leather when they die. I started cleaning up the village and then witnessed this. Am I the side character in this story? I had a better look at the lake I'd fished in yesterday and really liked how the surrounding terrain looked. This was the type of area I could build a cool base in. Of course, any good base starts with deforestation. I've been making fun of this iron golem, but in all fairness, he's like 9 feet tall, so he would probably destroy me in a fight. I had a look at this ant colony, and they actually take leaves from the trees, which is just such a cool feature. Shout out to the modders that make this kind of thing possible. You guys are amazing. On a less amazing note, I tried clearing away some of the trees in the village by burning them, and it quickly escalated into a raging forest fire. The cow pen was ablaze, the undergrowth was ablaze, the villagers were ablaze. It was not a good time. Due to the holes in the pen, some of the cows tried to escape. But due to their insatiable appetite for wheat, I was able to convince them back. I swear these guys love wheat more than their own families. I bred my future backpack, I mean this group of cows, and realized the fire was still going. It'll work itself out, it's fine. Rosia was busy face-planting into my door, and when I slipped past her, she decided to just no-clip straight through and take my bed for herself. I replaced the door with a fence gate to stop any future incidents, and then all I had to do was evict her from my property. Actually, seeing as she's a toolsmith, I'm pretty sure it's her property. Or at least it was her property. Instead of sleeping, I went out lighting up the village as best I could, because I'd made up my mind. I wanted to build a base near here, and my ability to exploit the villagers for money would be ruined if they all died to monsters in the night. I tried taking on this creeper, and completely missed my saber swipe, which meant he put a big fat dent in my new land. I didn't have much dirt, so I was forced to fix the hole the psycho way. If you properly fill up your creeper holes, you are a wonderful, wonderful person. I found an ant just hanging out upside down on my house, and I decided to name him Anthony. Listen, when I was like 7, I had a frog teddy and I named him Froggy. My ability to name things has been abysmal from a very young age. Day 15, Zip decided to try teleport out of the house, so I had to go track her down. Who's a good kitty? Who's a good kitty? Roach! Die, die, die. Thank you. The cows needed more food, and using my dual-wielding abilities, I was able to farm a ton of wheat. Unfortunately, while harvesting the wheat, I accidentally hit a villager. So I'm sorry, I have nothing against you personally, but you're gonna tell the guards, so... Oh no, a creeper, oh no. How is he still alive? He took so long that I just felt awful by the end of it. I mean, he didn't even drop any money. Seeing as leather isn't a guaranteed drop from cows, I was gonna need a fairly large number of them before I could get my backpack. I found some raw chicken on the floor and tried turning it into KFC by throwing it into lava. Eugenio, what kind of name is Eugenio? He was not impressed. I needed to wait for the cows to be able to breed again, so to pass the time, I headed into this very convenient cave in the middle of the village. I wasn't searching for diamonds though. I wanted all the coal and iron I could find. You see, I could sell all these resources to an armorsmith, which would not only provide me with plenty of emeralds, but also level up the armorsmith enough that they would sell me diamond armor. I was gonna need a boatload of resources, but the caves were more than willing to provide. While I was down here, I also took the opportunity to collect enough obsidian for 2 nether portals. Even though I was about 5,000 blocks away from my treehouse, traveling through the nether would shrink that to just 625 blocks. Because as we all know, 1 block in the nether equals 8 in the overworld. I'm pretty sure you could ask your grandma and she'd know the overworld to nether block ratio. While I was grabbing some redstone, this skeleton tried to go for an insane surprise attack, but he fell straight into a molten pit of lava. A plus for effort though. Ooh, skeleton fight. I wanted the crossbow guy to win, so naturally he lost. I then sat there and watched the other skeleton's futile efforts to take me out, as my thorns armor slowly chipped away at his fleeting life, until eventually he was nothing more than dust. Anyway, I was happy with all the ores I mined and decided to head to the surface. If my calculations are correct, the village should be... here. I had no idea where to go until I spotted the floating island in the distance. By looking at the orientation of my old wooden pillar, I was able to make a rough guess as to which direction the village was in. I'd be lying if I said I didn't feel like an absolute genius here. Hey kids, I have good news and I have bad news. The good news is, I have food for you guys. The bad news is, you're all orphans now. With the sacred 4 leather finally in my inventory, I was able to craft a backpack. After a few more minutes of fixing conflicting keybinds, I was able to successfully open my new backpack. I wanted to head back home to grab all my stuff and bring it to the village, but there was one last thing I needed to do. Before I put one foot in the nether, I wanted diamond armor. I followed this guy back to his house, and he was so surprised he flew through the wall and into a nearby hole. Once I got him out of the hole, it was trading time. At least it was until he didn't have the iron trade and therefore completely ruined any chance of me leveling him up further. It's fine, I'll just find a new villager. You! You will be my master armorer. Can you please stop jumping on the table? Fine, I'll just try another place. Okay, surely this guy will be the one. What's his name? Oh no. Eugenio thankfully clutched up and happily bought all of my iron. Before long, he was expert level, and I didn't have as many emeralds as I thought I would, so I was only able to buy diamond leggings. Thanks, Eugenio. Just gotta steal your stuff before I leave. I said a temporary goodbye to Zip, because today was the day I'd make the trip back to the treehouse. I made a pair of gold boots, built the portal, and fed the cows again, as one day in the very near future, I'll be turning them into steaks. It was time to head into the nether. I almost immediately spotted a new structure, but didn't get much time to take it in before a giant mosquito tried to bite my face off. I started mining quartz for some free XP, but the mosquito's brother came for revenge, and I managed to accidentally hit a zombie piglin. I tried to grab some netherrack to pillar up with, but my inventory was full. I was cornered on the edge of this cliff, and the only way to go was down. With just 1.5 hearts remaining, I ran as fast as my blocky Minecraft legs could take me. It wasn't too hard to heal up with my ridiculous amount of golden apples, and from there, the piglins made an orderly queue to be chopped down. I found a spawner nearby, but thankfully, these zombie piglins were unaware of the war that had just taken place. The chest didn't have much of interest, but I won't say no to some music discs. I made sure to collect some blocks so that I could avoid a situation like the one earlier. I headed up to the structure I saw earlier, which seemed to be some kind of ruined city. I was pretty wary that it'd be full of piglin brutes or something, but thankfully it was empty. While fighting some magma cubes, this guy decided it would be funny to drop directly onto my head. He also had one of the most painful death noises I've ever heard, right up there with horses. I really wanted to get a fire resistance potion, so I started trading with this piglin. He actually did give me what I wanted, but unfortunately, my intrusive thoughts told me to push him off the edge, so yeah. Oh, your dad? Nah, I haven't seen him. Karma was swift, with this mosquito causing me to fall off my bridge and take a giant chunk of fall damage. There was this cool nether-themed jungle temple nearby though. I was curious to see if the traps had been changed up, but they were the same terrible traps from the overworld jungle temple. I'd love to make a joke and complain here, but golden ingots really aren't that bad. I once again solved the piston puzzle by flicking the levers on and off repeatedly with zero plan in mind. Okay, that is criminal. Is that a chest full of loot or a garbage disposal? There was an extra chest in this room and it had an iron backpack, which was actually really good. This mosquito wanted a piece of me, but I dispatched him with my shield and saber combo. With all the nearby structures explored, I set off in the direction of my treehouse. I tried to speed bridge, and it went about as well as you'd expect. I'm not gonna lie, the giant mosquitoes, or crimson mosquitoes as they're officially called, were quickly becoming my most hated mob. Also, they're only supposed to spawn in the crimson forest, hence the name, but they decided to treat that rule as a suggestion. Oh great, more flying things. I tried so hard to kill this vulture, but he'd poured every skill point he had into evasion. Worryingly, my food supplies were running really low. All I had left was a loaf of bread, and even though I could eat the golden apples in a pinch, it would be a massive waste. The main issue was that due to the ridiculous amount of mosquitoes spawning, I was taking way more damage than any usual nether outing. This was in turn forcing me to eat way more food in order to, you know, stay alive. There was a nether-themed pillager outpost, which seemed interesting. I tried bridging again, and it's just painful to watch. I had a feeling there were piglin brutes lurking inside the outpost, so I pillared up, which turned out to be a very good decision. The chest had pork chops, which was amazing given my current situation, even if it's kind of weird that the piglins are keeping pork chops. I also found a netherite scrap. Seeing as I was having a good time, naturally a crimson mosquito had to come along and try ruin it. I then decided to wipe out all the piglins in the nearby area, and I'm not sure why. Actually, I do know why. It's because I found it funny. Conveniently, the outpost was almost right on the coordinates of my treehouse, so it looks like I'll be heading back home. Except I won't be heading back home because I'm an idiot and somehow miscounted the obsidian for the second portal. Hey guys, I know I just wiped out half of you in a completely unprovoked fight, but would you be able to trade me the obsidian I need? Thank you so much. With that little hiccup out of the way, I could finally build the nether portal. And return home. Well, this isn't exactly spot on, but I'm sure I can find my way back. I kind of know the area. And by kind of know the area, I mean I have absolutely no idea where I am. There's a jungle temple nearby though. Sadly, my lever flicking abilities failed me and I ended up just cheating in order to get the second chest. Hey, come on, stop booing me. Everyone cheats to get the second chest. I rewatched my footage and found the actual coordinates for my base, instead of just going off of memory alone. Now I actually know where I'm going. As the sun began to rise on day 19, I stumbled across a ruin I'd never seen before. It had a chest, but before I could get to looting, a crimson mosquito showed up. Except he tried fighting a gorilla and got absolutely bodied. It was beautiful. Oh no, bro's getting emoted on. I headed back over to the ruin and was almost 100% convinced the chest was a trap chest. Let's have a look. Yeah, I knew it. Just for fun, I decided to see what would have happened, and in hindsight, this could have ended really badly. I got really obsessed with punching this particular leaf block and then set back out on my journey home. Almost immediately, I found the pillager outpost, and I've never been so happy to see one in my life. I rode across the lake, and before long, the treehouse came into view. I was finally home. Also, that torch didn't break from the water. That's kind of weird. I began sorting out my inventory, and it was at this point that I realized I forgot to wear the diamond leggings. Sometimes my genius. It's almost frightening. I then crafted a copper shield. It has no statistical benefit over the iron one, In fact, it's actually slightly weaker, but that was a fair trade-off for how much less space it took up on the screen. Now that I wasn't being attacked by mosquitoes or piglins or just getting lost in general, I wanted to take the opportunity to figure out how to make some of the brand new foods. As you can see, it was going really well. Eventually, I got the hang of things. I wanted to make a hamburger, but you need beef patties, which are made from raw beef rather than steak, which was all I had. While organizing my storage, I found this animal dictionary I'd been given when generating the world, and gave it a read. Oh yeah, look at that! Crimson mosquitoes can only spawn in crimson forests. Well, isn't that funny? Care to explain? Alex? Now that I had all my stuff organized, I could start figuring out what to take back to the village, seeing as that was where I wanted to make my actual base. This treehouse has served me well, but it was time to move on to bigger and better things. I harvested my crops one last time, said goodbye to the sheep, who are now stuck here forever, and headed off. Well, actually, I had to go into the caves to mine obsidian for a new portal, and it was very boring. I spawned very close to the piglin outpost, showing that my original portal wasn't that bad of a guess. I could already see several crimson mosquitoes flying around, which is why I used an enderpearl to cross this lava lake. For some reason, there were endermen up here, but I wasn't complaining. I needed more pearls anyway. I recognized this monster, who I'd had several encounters with in my ocean-only 100 days. He just throws his kids at you, and it's really annoying. I spotted a temple nearby and began bridging over. I was extremely sus of this chest being out in the open, and broke it instead of opening it. It had an infinity book, and as it turned out, I was right to break it. This TNT could have caused some major problems, i.e. my death. I pearled over to this island and was minding my own business when I got attacked by a massive bone serpent. I tried killing it, but it was way too fast for me to land a hit. To complicate things, a ghast noticed me struggling and decided to make me struggle more. Hey guys, I'd like you to meet my nephew Stanley. Things really weren't looking good, and I'm not talking about Stanley. I needed to get off the island and try pearling, but completely overshot, causing me to fall right into the lava. My only chance at survival was eating a golden apple, and if I'd been a second too late, I would have lost everything. I wasn't out of the woods yet though. The soul sand beach I now found myself on was swarming with enemies, and my health once again started to dwindle. I finally took out the ghast, but the mosquitoes were intent on not letting me heal. By some miracle, I was able to find a quiet spot to heal up in. You're not invited. I'd gone a little off course and started realigning myself with the direction of the village nether portal. It's all the way across this giant lava lake. My first thought was to swim across it with the aid of a fire resistance potion, but seeing as my lava swimming abilities were practically non-existent, I abandoned the idea almost instantly. Like it or not, I was gonna have to take the long way around. I ran into a bastion with a ruined portal right next to it. I used the last 30 seconds of my fire res to swim over to the portal. I was hoping for a god apple, but given how rare they are, it wasn't surprising that I didn't get one. I then started bridging over to the bastion. Now that I've trespassed, I might as well say hello to my new neighbors. Okay, calm down with the 360s, mate. FaZe aren't gonna sign you. In all honesty, I was really scared going into this bastion. I felt like at any moment, a tidal wave of piglins would jump down from the upper floors and swarm me. I found a chest tucked in the corner with a diamond pickaxe. I'll take that any day. I still needed to check out the middle chest, and despite my fears, none of the piglins seemed to notice or even care. I decided to go to the chunkier top part of the bastion, and suddenly the lack of piglins earlier made a lot more sense. Oh well, now they're all dead. The sweet, juicy loot was all mine. We started off strong with a diamond shovel, and soul speed 3 is pretty decent to have. After making my way out of the bastion, I found myself in the Crimson Forest. A hoglin tried to steal my wallet, but I stole his life force. This was a really satisfying moment. If you've been watching this channel long enough, you'll know that I tried to record a jungle only 100 days about a year and a half ago, but ended up dying to hoglins on day 36. I tested out the diamond pickaxe I got from the bastion, and it had a pretty cool enchantment, although each time you mine, it loses 9 points of durability. I emerged from the tunnel, and there was my nether portal. All I had to do now was make it over this chasm. You can tell I was on edge, because I misplaced one block and it jump scared me so bad I threw all my netherrack away by accident. Once I managed to safely get down, I looted this temple which I somehow hadn't noticed before, and at last headed back to the overworld. It was pouring with rain, so I tried getting Zip to teleport inside, but it wasn't working. Nothing a bit of property damage can't fix. As I was harvesting wheat, I found a sick villager begging to be cured. Naturally, I didn't help in the slightest. I looked out over the lake, and I knew that this tree would be perfect for Treehouse 2.0. It's gonna be way bigger and better and cooler than the first one. I eagerly ran up to my new land, only to discover there was a silverfish ruin on it. Unlike the previous times I've come across these things, this time I was armed with TNT. It turned out there actually was some loot in this ruin, even if it was a protection 1 book and a single bottle of enchanting. If I was gonna make my home here, I needed to clear the area, so I got to work. Before long, I spotted a pack of gorillas nearby. I'd learned from Alex's animal dictionary that you could tame these guys with bananas, and he was true to his word. I have a pet gorilla. This is without a doubt the happiest moment of my entire life. I tried taming more, but unfortunately didn't have enough bananas. Hey, skeleton, get off this property which I've obtained through questionable means and may or may not have zero proof of legal ownership. I'd left my bed at the blacksmith and was too lazy to go get it, so I crafted a new one. Zip, what are you doing? I continued clearing away the nearby forest, firstly to free up the space, but also to get materials for my treehouse. I wanted to make a giant custom tree, and that was going to require a lot of jungle wood and leaves. I ended up finding a dark oak tree, which is like finding a polar bear in the middle of a desert, and unfortunately the leaves didn't drop any saplings. I would have loved to have had access to both dark oak and spruce, but I can settle for just spruce. In order to make the custom tree, I was going to use this pre-existing one as a starter, which meant I needed to shave off all its leaves and branches. Sorry tree, you gotta go bald. With the tree reset to default settings, I could start the build. I wanted to convert the trunk to a 3x3, which would allow me to carve out the inside and install a bubble elevator. I found some more ruins on my land, and they probably pose great historical value, but I can't say no to some extra lapis. I didn't have any blocks to scaffold with for the treehouse build, which is why I ended up spending the night collecting dirt. Day 24, Zip brought me a rabbit's foot, and I made sure to show my approval. I began building up the base of the tree in order to make it feel more organic. It'd be a little jarring if it was left as a perfectly smooth 3x3 cuboid. Unfortunately, thickening the trunk had used up most of my wood, and it wasn't long before I ran out. I then made my way over to the village in order to feed my growing population of Big Macs. I mean, cows. The villagers had left this big pile of melons out, which must mean they're free. Now that I think about it, it had been a while since I'd seen a villager, and considering the things I've done, I don't blame them for hiding. There was a jungle temple nearby, so I headed over to check it out. I don't even know why, considering the loot's gonna be terrible. Oh! Okay then, spam the levers as per usual and grabbed all the extra loot. I spent the next few days working on the top of the tree, and as you can imagine, it took a ton of jungle wood to build. I found it pretty difficult to build natural looking tree branches in survival. It's so much easier to do this kind of stuff in creative, especially since you can fly around and not worry about plummeting to your death. I got about half of the top branches done before deciding to take a break. Day 27, I caught a nice shot of the sunrise and had a look at my tree from afar. It's fine. We just gotta trust the process. I found a stingray flopping about on land and tried to put him out of his misery, and I think I just ended up making it worse. While I was feeding the cows, a villager came up to me, and it was Josephina. Hey Josephina, how's it going? You're suing me for breaking and entering. Oh. I'm going to the Nether. The lawyers will never take me alive. Jerome was also hiding out in the Nether, so at least I've got company. All jokes aside, I have no idea why I did this. I spent about 30 seconds in here and then just left. Anthony was still hanging out upside down on my old house. I'm surprised he hasn't thrown up yet. Back at the base, I dumped my inventory into a chest and crafted a bunch of buckets because I wanted to make that bubble elevator. Usually people use one water bucket at the top and then use kelp to turn the entire thing into water sources. But seeing as kelp doesn't grow in the jungle, I was gonna have to do it the hard way. Sure, it was tedious, but by the end of the day, I could rocket straight to the top of the tree. The best part was leaping from the top, Assassin's Creed style. As night fell, I got back to work on the top of the tree. finishing off the other half. Now that I built the branches of the tree, it was time to add the leaves. I broke two pairs of shears collecting leaves, which I thought would be enough.
It's not enough.
I started layering the leaves on the branches, and by the end of the day, I'd completely run out. I'd been in the same area for a while and decided it was time to explore. The one thing I did forget was food, which I noticed almost immediately, but chose to keep going forward anyway. I leapt through the trees, just like Tarzan. Okay, maybe not quite like Tarzan. I found a ruin made of bricks and uncovered some buried treasure in it. Sharpness 2 isn't bad. Before I left, I made sure to collect most of the bricks, because they're a pretty annoying block to get usually. And I also made sure not to forget these bookshelves. Of course, since I was out exploring the jungle, it wasn't long before I found a well. I basically found a bottle of smart water, because it was completely worthless and provided zero value. Soon after, I found a village tucked away in the leaves. It was good to know that even if all the villagers back at my base died, I could always come here and force these guys to do my bidding instead. I stole a red bed, but I replaced it with my white one, so it was a fair trade. I started defacing the villagers' sacred ruins in search of treasure, but gave up. I then discovered these bookshelves, which were easily 10 times better than whatever the ruins had to offer. The next house I broke into was owned by a child, and I guarantee Trevor's done some serious tax evasion on his allowance in order to afford this thing. I wasn't sure what I was expecting when I walked out of the village, but it definitely wasn't an airship. I probably should have slept, but this was way too cool not to explore right now. I could have very easily been sniped off this ladder by a skeleton, but thankfully that wasn't the case. I was extremely cautious once I was inside, since if I got swarmed by mobs in a surprise attack, I wouldn't live more than a few seconds. I found an engine room, but this redstone contraption thing didn't seem to be functional. Before long, I came across a spawner, and I did not want to take on these axe-wielding skeletons in a fair fight. Plus, since they had chest plates, my saber was only doing 75% of its usual damage. I crafted a temporary iron sword to deal with the skeletons and slowly slashed my way through the hall. It took absolutely forever, as you can tell by the fact my sword was already at half durability by the time I made it through. There was a small area up in the roof, although the loot wasn't exactly anything to write home about. I headed up the stairs and came face to face with even more skeletons. Also, if you think I'm playing this too safe, I got hit once and lost a quarter of my health. It takes me 10 hits to kill these guys, whereas they can drop me in just 4. I cleared out all the axe skeletons and found a new type of skeleton. The blindness skeleton. I kept getting hit by the potion they dropped on death, and within a few minutes, I was completely out of food. There was no other choice but to temporarily retreat. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to present Cooking with Mosey. First, jump in a nearby lake and start slaughtering all the marine life with your sword. Then, dig underground for natural resources to construct your kitchen appliances. Craft a knife with nothing but your bare hands. Using the knife, carefully fill it. Just cut the fish up. Place them in your cooker, and within a few seconds, they should be smoked to perfection. Thank you all for watching Cooking with Mosey. With a pile of fish fillets and terrible reviews from audiences around the globe, I made my way back up the blimp. I used my axe instead of my saber, which worked so much better. I took care of the final spawner and approached my reward. Was my pain and suffering worth just 2 diamonds? That's debatable. There was also a plague asylum map, which sounded interesting, in a freaky kind of way. I climbed onto the top of the blimp and then headed to sleep. I leapt from the top into knee-deep water, which obviously broke my fall perfectly. Ah, child! I started making my way back home, and since I hadn't gone super far out, I didn't bother with nether travel. Also, since I took a slightly different way back, I could find more structures as I went, like this pillager outpost. As always, the loot was... how do I put this? Oh yeah, trash! I proceeded to attack the pillagers for not having better stuff for me to steal, and then started pillaring up to see what else I could find. I instantly noticed this giant ruin made of stone bricks. It was a jungle version of a nether fortress. It didn't have blaze spawners or wither skeletons, instead it had an entire city's worth of drowned. I found one with a trident, and I'll admit it, he was destroying me. I had to take measures. I discovered a chest with some iron and gold in it, which wasn't bad. although some of the others were definitely questionable. The pillagers had followed me to the fortress, and had even put fireworks in their crossbows, which was slightly terrifying. I couldn't kill the captain since I would get bad omen, so I dipped, and before long my giant half-finished tree came into view. I swapped my white bed for the Chad red one I got from the village, and then got to work. I wanted to start a farm, and for that I would need to put in that sweet, sweet manual labor. I couldn't just live on melons and fish fillets forever. In order to tide me over until the crops grew, I did some fishing. It's really exciting, trust me guys. I put in some extra effort collecting ingredients and was able to make myself some sushi. I collected a ton of leaves because it was time to get back to work on the tree. There's not a lot to say here, so instead I'm gonna shamelessly ask you to subscribe. It's completely free and you can always change your mind later. A creeper tried creeping up on me, so I hit him with a pretty terrible trick shot actually. I headed over to the village and began mass breeding the army of cows that were in this tiny pen. By collecting the leaves in the village, it helped to clean it up, because it's very overgrown here. Look at me being nice to the citizens, even though I'm only doing this so that it'll make my future plans for this place run smoother. I found the queen of the ant colony and gave her some of my leaves as a peace offering. The ant nation's size was honestly starting to become a little scary. As I rode back over to the treehouse, I could hear a music disc playing. I mean, I could hear a music disc, but you guys are getting copyright free music. After doing some digging, I found the source of the copyright free music, and it was this zombie wearing a special backpack. I didn't want to ruin his vibe by killing him, so I just left him be. If he wants to chill in his cave and listen to some tunes, who am I to stop him? Some of the crops had grown, which meant at least now I had some bread to live off of. But in the dead of night, I spotted a crimson mosquito. Seeing as they're my sworn enemy, I tried my best to take it out. Unfortunately, it got away. But I'll get my revenge. For now, I'll settle for this zombie. Day 35, I grabbed some more dirt and got back to work finishing leaf placing simulator. I'm really happy with how the tree turned out. I've been trying to get better at organic stuff for a while, so this was a great payoff. Some skeletons tried moving in on my property, so I started my morning off with a light brawl. Now that the tree was done, it was time to actually build a treehouse. I didn't want to turn all the grass to podzol by growing a big spruce tree, so I built up a few blocks and still ended up with a giant brown smudge on my land. I fed Zip some fish because she's the best cat ever and realized there was a fly on my land. Not anymore. As I dove into the lake, a creeper followed me in, and I tried not to think about how horribly wrong things could have been if he jumped me while I was at the crafting table. The reason I was in the lake was to visit Music Zombie's cave, as I needed granite. I couldn't find Music Zombie though, only his parents and his cousins. Actually, he had a lot of cousins. Also, I have no idea what's going on here. I made this mod pack in 2 afternoons with a solid 20 minutes of playtesting. If this video gets 10k likes, I'll release it on CurseForge for you guys to try out. My search for granite led me deeper and deeper into the caves, and I ended up finding some diamonds. It seemed kinda pointless to mine them right now since I would likely get a full enchantment setup going soon, so I decided to come back when I had Fortune 3. It was dark when I emerged at the surface, and I spent some time lighting up the general area. We have a strict no creepers allowed policy. My first order of business the following morning was to light up the branches of the tree. I knew if I put it off, I'd definitely get blown up sooner or later. With that out of the way, I could begin work on the treehouse itself. I got the general structure built, but when it came to putting in the roof, I didn't actually like the granite. After an emergency pit stop to collect spruce wood, I got back to work, adding a protective guardrail around the edge as well as a much better looking spruce roof. I spent the next few days adding some smaller details and decor, like this chimney that's basically a fire hazard begging to happen. I did my best to really fill up the space and make it feel like a proper home. The main issue I ran into was setting up the enchantment table. I couldn't seem to find a way to place all the bookshelves down without it all looking super ugly. But then I had an idea. Why not just use the inside of the tree as an enchanting room? Even though in real life this would completely destroy the structural integrity of the branches, we're in Minecraft, so we can do what we want. It turned out great and definitely had a magical vibe about it. The only problem was that I was missing a bookshelf, so I could only get level 28 enchantments. With the enchantment room mostly sorted, I could now rebrand this day to Storage Day. For those of you that don't know what it is, I mean it's pretty self-explanatory. Thanks to my backpacks, I could take everything up at once, and from there it was just a matter of putting all my items in the right chests. I could have used item frames to label the chests, but I cheaped out and went for signs instead. I rediscovered these redstone lamps I'd looted from the airship and thought I'd try them out for the base. I know they're supposed to be bright, but with this shader, they were blinding. Day 42 started with a rainbow. That was nice. I watched the neighbors burn to a crisp and then spotted a roach. No, you get back here right this second. I planted some sugarcane on the shore and didn't bother making a farm since I didn't need much of it. I set up a small paddling pool so that I could leap off the top of the treehouse down to my front lawn. I harvested all my crops, and in order to expand the farm, I had to turn all the pods to path blocks in order to use the hoe on them. I actually spent most of the day just farming. I had loads of seeds and wanted to make sure not a single one went to waste. I visited the beef factory and it had some beef for me. Wonderful. I chopped the beef into patties, cooked them perfectly, and at last I could craft the legendary hamburger. Of course, now that I had one hamburger, the logical thing to do was to make 11 more of them. With every bite, I could feel my organs shutting down, but my god, it was delicious. I was able to make a couple books with the leather I got from the beef factory, and at last I could get level 30 enchantments. I had 45 levels, and I was gonna put them to very good use. I crafted a diamond sword and almost immediately got a really good enchantment. Leech 3 means I'll restore health by killing enemies. I also got protection 4 on a chestplate. Sadly, I rolled just efficiency 4 on 2 diamond pickaxes, with fortune 3 nowhere in sight. To round things off, I went for unbreaking 3 on some leggings in the hopes of getting prop 4, and it was a great plan. I wanted to combine my 2 chest plates together, but decided to wait until I had mending as well. Otherwise, I'd have to add it later at an increased price. For now, I stored away my good chest plate. With all the enchanting out of the way, I started prepping, because it was time to track down the mysterious Plague Asylum. I hung my saber up in an item frame as a sign of respect. It served me well. I noticed I had a rotten tomato in my inventory, so I found Lewis and threw it at him. That's what you deserve for not having the iron trade. I visited McDonald's one last time before heading off to bed. Got a big day tomorrow, after all. I had a look at the map and thought I knew roughly which direction the asylum was in. I was gonna be using nether travel since structures on maps are usually thousands of blocks away. I tried knocking this ghast fireball back with a piercing crossbow and just ended up killing him with the arrow, so I guess I failed the task successfully. My plans were slightly derailed when I found a nether fortress almost immediately, which is by far one of my luckiest fortress spawns. Usually I gotta search thousands of blocks for one of these things. I began collecting blaze rods, which was fairly easy since my sword had looting too. And speaking of looting too, I was even able to get myself a wither skull. If you're wondering why I've switched to sword instead of sticking with my saber, it's because the saber is pretty ineffective against enemies in modded structures, due to them usually having chest plates. I started making my way through this basalt delta, but complications quickly arose when I ran into one of these blue guys. I was in extreme danger of getting knocked off into the lava, but thankfully was able to parkour my way to safety. I had no clue where to make my exit portal, so I just decided to YOLO it. I ended up in a cave, and the first thing I did was fall through my bed. I'd ended up bringing along my extremely damaged diamond pick, so I had to spend a few minutes mining and smelting iron in order to make a temporary one. After digging myself out of the underground, I checked the map. I'd overshot a bit, but it looked like I actually wasn't that far away anymore. I first focused on aligning myself on the x-axis. I found a jungle fortress, but didn't bother exploring. Before long, the top left of the map started to fill in. Before I could get to the Plague Asylum though, I ran into yet another jungle fortress. All the bad loot I found in these was instantly redeemed by the fact that this chest had an efficiency 2 diamond pickaxe. I was a little confused about where the asylum actually was, until I realized the entire thing had generated underneath the lake. I dug in, and why? Just why? I blocked off the entrance with some netherrack and was very grateful for it, since within seconds a literal army of enemies were crowding around me. They all died in just a couple hits, which I assume is supposed to be because of their plague. I could see a chest in this giant glass bottle and started bridging over to it. I was starting to grasp the situation of this place a little better. The husks seemed to be the patients, with skeletons dressed as the plague doctors. I broke into the bottle and that's what I call loot. I needed to take out the spawners, but the skeleton doctors could eat hits like there were no tomorrow, on top of dropping splash potions of harming when they died. Thankfully, there were no ranged enemies, so I was able to safely take out the spawner from above. And once the place was clear, I dropped down and removed the husk spawner too. I saw another active spawner in the distance, before realizing this entire place was filled to the brim with spawners. I decided to worry about that later. With all the enemies gone, I could properly check out the first area. I found a Bad Omen 5 potion, as well as this thing. A single particle of this stuff would likely kill me in 2 seconds flat. I'm honestly not surprised all these guys have the plague. I started working my way through the winding corridors, and it was at this point I was beginning to grasp just how massive this place was. Not to mention, there were barrels scattered everywhere full of loot. It wasn't diamonds or anything like that, but there were loads of useful resources like iron and coal. I found some kind of brewing station, and took out the witches who were likely responsible for all these juiced up potions. They were getting paid good money for it, too. This place was so big, I honestly can't even commentate over most of what happened without it getting repetitive. I went from tunnel to tunnel, killing every monster I came across, all the while scooping up every ounce of precious treasure I could get my hands on. I also found the most secure door I've ever laid eyes upon. The security team nailed it with this. I ran into a small roadblock when there was a plague doctor spawner I couldn't reach with my pick, but this place had given me more than enough resources to deal with it using other means. I noticed that as I descended down the floors of this madhouse, the doctors got more and more powerful, with these diamond armored ones being the strongest. I also started testing out some of the potions I found on the husks, from as safe of a distance as possible. I even found this potion that gives me every single beacon effect at once. I found living areas, cursed pits, diamond ore. This place had it all. Well, apart from healthy people. All good things must come to an end though, and eventually I reached the very bottom. I began digging back up to the surface and reached it just as the sun was setting. It was nice to finally be back in the world of the living. I wasted no time constructing a portal and jumped straight through to the nether, because I really wanted to get back home. My first step towards doing that was falling straight into lava, and then mining straight into lava. I was a little lost, but it wasn't long before I spotted the familiar nether fortress. Strangely enough, not a single crimson mosquito bothered me throughout the entire nether journey. Maybe they had a day off or something, but whatever the case, I wasn't complaining. I made it back to the portal, and it was great to see the familiar sight of the treehouse. I said hi to Zip, and then climbed into my bed for a well-deserved rest. My inventory and backpacks were an absolute mess, so I began organizing them. This is the spoils from the plague asylum. Yeah, that seems pretty balanced. I'd also somehow managed to acquire nearly all the music discs. Aside from my net worth now rivaling that of Jeff Bezos, I also had 58 levels. Unfortunately, while preparing some gear for enchanting, I accidentally grindstoned my Prop 4 chestplate. I got some decent enchants, like these Feather Falling 4 boots, even if they had Curse of Garbage, Fire Protection 3. I also got this helmet, which had Insight 3, one of the modded enchantments. Insight boosts your XP gain, which as we'll learn later on, is incredibly overpowered. I did some combining, getting this pair of leggings, as well as an Efficiency 5 pick. I didn't manage to get fortune, but considering recent events, I don't think that really matters. I wanted to get a stable and consistent source of XP, and arrived at the conclusion that I should make a villager trading hall. Before I could do that though, I needed to set up a villager breeder. I found Lewis, and working for me was the last thing he wanted to do. Unfortunately for him, his arms are permanently bound together, and therefore he can't climb out of the minecart. I began digging Lewis's new estate, and as you can see, I'm putting a ton of effort in. Voila, my masterpiece. Despite having access to over 10 stacks of iron, I was cheaping out on rails and refused to craft more, which made this whole thing take way longer than it should have done. Once I had Lewis in, I returned to the village to grab a second willing participant. I chose Brandon, although I realized I'd have to sleep since he was more occupied with going to bed than being captured. I really don't know why I was so stubborn about not crafting more rails. We moved at a snail's pace through the grass and shrubbery until eventually we connected with the main track. I needed beds for Lewis and Brandon, as well as for the future workers, I mean their children. Plus I needed to feed them, so I took the liberty of harvesting all the villagers' crops. Thankfully, Brandon had been keeping a pair of sheep, so I'll be able to breed them for bonus wool. The guards were doing an absolutely incredible job of protecting their citizens and their possessions. After donating some beds and bread to my villager prison breeder, I removed the soul sand from my bubble elevator, making it just a Vata. I mean, it doesn't elevate me anymore. This is a terrible... Cut that. Don't put that in the video. Anyway, I did it so that I could swim up and down and not have to leap off the treehouse into a pool of water every time. I knew that the 25 loaves of bread I donated to the breeder wouldn't last particularly long, so I spent the night harvesting and expanding the farm. I checked the breeder the next morning, eagerly awaiting the results, and not a single kid. Come on guys, I need you to step it up here. My employees were gonna need a place to work, so I began clearing out an area. It was a much easier process with diamond tools. Now that's more like it. I can't wait till they're all grown up and have no choice but to work 24/7 in my trading hall. Don't worry about it, Timmy. Go play. Just enjoy your childhood. All 20 minutes of it. I continued clearing away the undergrowth and collected some dirt for landscaping. I managed to catch a zombie, otherwise known as an illegal discount coupon. We're gonna feed the villagers to him, cure them, and then as a thank you for saving their lives, they give us 99% off. The trading hall was gonna be pretty big, so this hill was gonna have to be fixed. I disrespected this zombie by killing him with my hoe, and then started planning out the dimensions of the hall. The zombie nation wasn't taking that disrespect laying down, and began sending their soldiers, which made planning the trading hall basically impossible. I thought I'd go to bed to put a stop to it, but by the time I got to the bed, the sun came up. I got poisoned by a stingray as I entered the caves, which isn't exactly my idea of a good morning. The reason I was down here was for granite, and yes, I promise I actually do use it this time. I didn't need much, since I already had loads, but I wanted an extra stack or two. I also needed some stone, so I dug a giant tunnel. As I mined this coal, I realized I was getting way more XP than usual, which reminded me of my Insight helmet. I broke into a ravine and saw that just mining some redstone or killing a couple monsters was leveling me up at a rapid pace. I didn't have time to explore though, and started heading back. Before I left, I took care of a couple more enemies, netting me a power 2 bow. I checked up on a legal discount coupon, and he seemed to be fine, although he was shaking his head a lot. If he's trying to signal that he doesn't want to be involved with my multi-level marketing scheme, too bad, he's got no choice. Oh, a zombie. Behold, my expert fighting skills. I had nowhere near enough furnaces to smelt all the clay, so I was forced to make a giant wall of them. Day 54, an Enderman decided to help himself to my lawn, so I helped him cancel his life subscription. I went into the Nether and watched this ant, who was clearly very lost. I'd forgotten to bring gold armor, but thankfully the local piglin was off hanging out with his zombie friends. I needed a ton of warped wood for this build, so for the next 10 minutes or so, this forest was gonna be my new home. I have no idea why, but there wasn't a single crimson mosquito about again. Some of you might be thinking I tweaked the mod pack or something, but I haven't laid a finger on their settings. Of course, I'm not complaining, the Nether felt like heaven without them. I'm just confused on why they vanished. Oh wait, no, we're back to normal. As I was heading back, this ant almost went back into the Nether portal, so I decided to try and save him. Unfortunately, he's an ant, so he had no idea that I was attempting to help him and instead wandered off. I give him 5 minutes before a mosquito gets him. I arrive back at the treehouse. I arrive back at the treehouse to sort out my inventory, before heading back into the Nether. I wanted to put my Insight helmet to the test and see just how much XP I could get from mining quartz. I take back my earlier comments about the mosquitoes vanishing, they were everywhere now. I couldn't even bridge without one of them launching themselves at my face. My plan with the quartz worked perfectly, and before long I was already at level 37. On my way back to the portal, this guy decided to fight me unprovoked right in front of his kid, and I'm pretty sure he's traumatized for life now. You know what? I'm gonna head out now. I was determined to get protection 4 on a chest plate, but the enchantment table would not stop offering me soulbound. If you're wondering what soulbound does, it means your items stay in your inventory when you die. Really useful for a hardcore player. Although on the more positive side of things, I had all the materials needed to build the trading hall. For some reason, replay mod bugged out, as I'm completely invisible for the entire time lapse. I really like the color palette I used. I think the pinkish granite works as a great base for the bright blue logs. The bottom area doesn't serve any purpose, it's the top part where all the prisoners are gonna go. I started off day 60 with a nice swan dive. I headed down to check on my workers, and oh my days, there's a lot of you. Wait, your name's Sybil? Leslie? Okay, Lulu, that's not bad. You're called Winnell. Brandon, you named your child Winnell. Let's just think about that, Brandon. Winnell. I can't do this anymore, Brandon. I really can't. I tried my best to ignore the fact that his child's life was completely ruined and started building a roller coaster. The first part was going to be a stop at illegal discount coupons house. The second is this really fun slope and turn combo, which then deposits the rider in the trading hall where they're forced to work for the rest of their lives. Although I did forget to build that photo booth thing where you can buy a really bad picture of yourself on the ride for like $15. I then had some kind of spiritual awakening or something and found out I could telepathically harvest the crops with my mind. I have no idea what mod adds this, but it looks hilarious and it's faster than breaking and replanting. Now that night had fallen, it was safe to move discount coupon into his new home. Honestly, if you fall for a trap as obvious as this, you probably deserve to be in here. I tested out the roller coaster and it worked exactly as I planned. I planted more crops, although at this point it was less for feeding the villagers and more just for decoration. I tried using the redstone lamps in lampposts, but I still didn't like how bright they were. A lantern looks a lot better. I added in some fences too, and I'm really starting to like this place. I didn't want to just leave the bottom of the trading hall as grass and converted it into a crop storage type thing. With that out of the way, it was finally time to start converting the villagers. I began with Lulu, and I'm sure she's lovely, but unfortunately, I need money. It was only after she got turned into a zombie that I realized I completely forgot to make weakness potions. I've basically just given her the plague without having a cure. I attempted to make a brewing stand with a stick, and yeah, let's just move on from that. I needed to get a brown mushroom, and since they don't spawn in the jungle, my only option was to go to the Nether. Somehow the queen ant had ended up down here, and I have so many questions. In order to get the brown mushrooms, I was gonna need to get up on the Nether roof. And the first thing I did was build a portal to get back down. In theory, it should link up with the one in the village. Oh, we'll worry about that later. Back on the Nether roof, I went around picking mushrooms from the bedrock. I have no idea how they can grow on bedrock, but I think it's best not to ask. A zombie piglin came back with me, and I tried to get him back home, but he wasn't having any of it. Even though I'm lost, there's nothing a bit of extra render distance can't fix. As I was heading back, I found a ruin with a night vision potion, and immediately regretted using it. This just looks so cursed, make it stop. I came across a temple, and seeing as I had full diamond armor, decided to full send the chamber. As I expected, I ended up having to fight off an entire extended colony of silverfish. It took so long for me to kill them all that it was daytime when I took care of the final few. I got 3 diamonds though, so I'd say it was worth it. I found the brick ruin that I've ransacked earlier, so I knew I was fairly close to the treehouse. I had to pillar up again in order to check, but before long I was back home safe and sound. I had 38 levels due to insight and managed to get a protection 3 chestplate, as well as a leech 3 sword which I'll be combining with my current one later. You alright up there, mate? I sheared the sheep, visited McDonald's, and finally put leaves on the lower branches of the tree. I was offered fortune 2 on a pickaxe, gave it some thought, and felt it was the best I was gonna get. The final ingredient I needed for the weakness potion was a spider eye, so I mined in a straight line in the hopes of running into an abandoned mineshaft. I found a cave, which was promising, but then it turned out it just connected to a ravine I'd already explored. I didn't give up and kept looking, which resulted in me both getting a spider eye and finding some diamonds. These guys said they found the diamonds first, but seeing as they're now dead, I found them first. I went through cave after cave, ravine after ravine, but still no sign of a mineshaft. After a full day of searching, I was forced to admit defeat. I could still brew 3 weakness potions using my 1 spider eye though, so it wasn't a total failure. I had to shovel sand in order to craft glass bottles, and by the time I was done, it was already day 64. I was approached by a flaming zombie villager child, and I felt compelled to save her. Not you. I got her into a small box, although what I didn't realize at the time was that she had naturally spawned, so she despawned like 5 minutes after. While I waited for the sand to smelt, I did some more enchanting, and finally got Fortune 3. I've never been so unlucky with this enchantment before. With the weakness potions ready, I could at last cure Lulu. Sorry for leaving you as a zombie for like 4 days straight. While I waited for her to cure, I just cleared away some trees, having already forgotten about the zombie villager child. And look at that, you're safe and sound, no harm done. For the most part anyway. I wasted no time in setting up the next villager, which happened to be Leslie. Brandon? I gave Leslie the magic cure and started leveling up Lulu. She would pay me 1 emerald per iron ingot, and is that a fire aspect axe? I had to wait for Leslie to recover, so in the meantime I started collecting spruce wood in order to build a sheep pen. I was gonna need to go bed mining for ancient debris in the near future, and that wouldn't be a very good plan if I didn't have any beds. The pen took way too long to build. I mean, it's a sheep pen, I should not care this much about how it looks. But by the time it got dark, I finally had a design that I liked. Leslie, my man, you're cured! He stared at me the whole time he was going up the roller coaster. He definitely has a grudge. I chose to make him a toolsmith, and alongside Lulu, he's gonna be one of my main methods of making money. Usually I'd build an iron farm, but I was fairly sure I had enough iron to sell it to them daily until the end of the 100 days. After some last minute readjustments to the sheep pen, it was time to actually put sheep in it. I was dreading this, but it actually went smoothly. Before long, I had myself a lovely fluffy family whose wool I will be using for high-grade explosives. The stingray had returned to my water elevator, so I had to let him know who was boss. Georgie was the final villager to be cured, and I sent her up to the trading hall. My plan was to get her to sell me mending, but sharpness 4 for just 3 emeralds is an absolute steal. No, seriously, I am robbing this woman. Get out of my house, stingray. I enchanted another helmet with Prot 3, and once I have mending books, these helmets are gonna make a better combination than Arby's and a trash can. I just really hate Arby's. I harvested my crops with my mind once again and defended my land from some unwanted guests. I woke all my villagers up in the middle of the night by throwing baguettes at them and then went to sleep. I'd used my last weakness potion, which meant I needed to try again at finding a mineshaft. This spider donated me his eye before I started digging, which had to be a good sign. Surprisingly enough, it actually was a good sign. I got into a little scuffle with this kid, but he's fine, as you can see by this footage. It didn't take long before I found a cave spider spawner, which for some reason was guarded by a crimson mosquito. Why are you spawning in the overworld? Stop. I started farming, and before long I was able to leave the caves with 9 eyes, which was more than enough. With the potions brewed, I was able to get the zombie villager shaped ball rolling again. Unfortunately for Winnell, it looks like she's involved in that. Also, how did that guy get in there? I did some trading and then began shearing the sheep. This one thought he could escape, but no. No, he can't. I had a suspicion that— oh, hi Lewis. I had a suspicion that the villagers in the trading hall were close enough to claim the beds in the breeder, which meant there wouldn't be any more kids in here unless I added extra beds. It was starting to get pretty lively in the trading hall. I leveled up Winnell and realized she would pay 1 emerald per cabbage, which was the exact moment dollar signs appeared in my eyes. Before I entered the cabbage business though, I needed Ronna to be a mending librarian, except she offered me insight too, which I thought I could add to all my armor pieces and triple my current XP gain. I harvested my cabbages for the first time at this base and then sold them to Winnell, making an absolutely incredible profit. Oh, it's you again. You know what? Let's be friends. See, look, we're bonding. Oh look, a perfectly normal day with zero subtext or implied humor. I began curing another villager and in the meantime made tons and tons of money. I didn't have much to do until they were healed, so to kill time I increased the size of the cabbage patch. That's literally all I did. I did also add a small tomato patch actually, or as an American would say, a tomato patch. Rate my accent on a scale of 1 to 10. I would personally give myself an 11. I enchanted my shield with Phalanx 2, which lets me move faster while holding it. I started bright and early the following morning, trying to get a mending librarian. The villager of choice was Buffy, and she was not cooperating. Getting a mending librarian is just so tedious. By the end of the day, I'd broken over 200 lecterns without a single mending offer. It was even worse at night since villagers don't take jobs as much. It also doesn't help when they walk as you're placing the lectern, causing it to disappear and forcing you to reload the world in order to get it back. Salvation eventually came, and while it was definitely overpriced, it was the best I was gonna get. I also now had an infinite money glitch, as I could buy these bookshelves for 2 emeralds from Georgie, break them down, and sell the books at 1 emerald apiece to Buffy. At long last, I could get myself a perfect helmet. I also added mending to my leggings, and it was at this point that I learned you can't put insight on anything other than a helmet. It was a pretty painful moment. Somehow, all the sheep had managed to cram themselves into the tomato farm, so that needed rectifying. Even more confusingly, there were somehow 2 villagers in the pen now, Catherine and Mohammed. The villager breeder is protected by several sets of fence gates. How are they managing this? I started shearing the sheep, and the Phalanx 2 enchantment makes this borderline unwatchable. Brandon, get up, make more babies. It had been a long time since I'd gone out on an expedition and felt it was long overdue. I went in a completely unexplored direction with the same goal as always, find a really cool new structure. I found a jungle temple and it had some okay loot. I did end up resorting to cheating to get the second chest. After a while of jumping through the treetops, I found what I thought was some kind of hobbit house, but it turned out to be a chicken coop. This was actually an incredibly good find, because the endgame set of armor I'm going for requires a lot of feathers. The gang was making a run for it, but I lured them back with some delicious wheat seeds. I don't know why they go crazy over these. My initial plan was to just camp out here for a few days and keep breeding them, but I realized something. That's incredibly boring. It would also be a nightmare taking them back home through the jungle, since they get stuck on the terrain incredibly easily. I decided to push on with my adventure and deal with that problem later. I found a jungle fortress, and while the first chest had nothing special, this one was able to pull through with an enchanted diamond shovel. Before long, I was in a village with the worst infrastructure I've ever seen. I made sure not to forget the gold block from the ruin portal. It was fun just running around in the jungle, wondering when the next building would show up from behind the trees. I came across an absolutely massive jungle fortress, but it was overshadowed instantly by what looked to be a jungle mansion. I made a beeline for it, and as suspected, this was a woodland mansion. Not only do these places hold some of the strongest enemies in the game, in this mod pack they get to wear armor too. Hehe, I'm in trouble, aren't I? While the chest loot in mansions is practically non-existent, the main attraction here are the Totems of Undying dropped by Evokers. Evokers have a very interesting attack strategy called hide in a corridor, spawning as many demon babies as possible, and then let the Vindicators do all the work. Thanks to their tiny hitbox and fast movement speed, the Vexes are easily some of the most frustrating mobs to deal with. Just come here so I can kill you. Oh, there's the Evoker. Yeah, nice try, mate. Oh, any chance we can talk about this, fellas? I got absolutely destroyed, and with just 4 hearts remaining, I ran for my life. Even on death's door, I for some reason decided to conserve my god apple, because I'm a complete idiot. Thankfully, the regular golden apples gave me enough of a boost that I could take out the axe-wielding maniacs. I put a creeper-sized dent in the property value and had to remind this crimson mosquito he was in the wrong dimension. And at the end of it all, the reward for nearly getting chopped in half was, drumroll please, loyalty 1. Skeleton, do you mind? I collected some wool from a nearby room and used it to craft a bed. As I left the next morning, I found this zombie who really wanted some cocoa beans. There you go, man. Enjoy. The mansion was a cool enough structure that I felt satisfied and was happy to head back home. Ooh, a parrot. I have 8 seeds, so that should be plenty. What? I'd used way too many seeds on him to give up now, so after punching some grass, I finally managed to tame him. I also never bothered naming him. Along the way, I found a floating island. After receiving the usual golden apple supplies, I dug down and murdered the zombies minding their own business. No hard feelings, right guys? Now that I had totems of undying, this reckless water bucket was perfectly acceptable. I found a village, although it wasn't the same one from before. I had to steal some of their seeds to feed my chickens since I'd fed the parrot all of mine. Hi man, what's up? You get that joke way too much, don't you? Please go away. I'd completely forgotten the coordinates of the chicken coop, but somehow managed to find it anyway. I fed everyone the stolen seeds and started digging down. The only way I was gonna get these guys back to the base was with nether travel. I built the portal and... oh no. Seeing as I was right in the home of the Crimson Mosquitoes, I wasted no time setting up a shelter around the portal. I was gonna need to make a tunnel all the way back to the original portal, since otherwise the chickens would definitely get blown up by a ghast or fall in lava. Before long, the tunnel was finished, and I started ferrying the birds back. It would have been great to have had leads, but I was gonna have to make do with wheat seeds. Things seemed to be going perfectly, right up until the end. I needed to wait on the other side of the portal so that the chickens would go through, but I hadn't left enough space. I kept holding the seeds while fixing my mistake, which led to half of my precious livestock falling off the platform. Thankfully, I was able to get everyone back into the tunnel safe and sound. It had been a difficult journey, but we'd all made it back, safe and sound. Most of us had made it back safe and sound. I intended to raise these chickens with love and care, which is why I put them in this 2x2 hole. After sorting out my inventory, I leapt off the treehouse and nailed the landing. My money machines! My friends! Did you guys miss me? I did an absolute ton of trading and managed to get up to level 35. I really wanted to get a pair of Prot 4 boots so that I could override the fire protection on my current pair. Score! I had 3 pairs of boots that I needed to combine together, and since I'd exhausted all the villager trades for the day, I went into the nether to get XP from quartz. Insight 3, being the very balanced enchantment that it is, helped a ton. I made sure to kill this hoglin because no, I still haven't forgiven them for ruining my original jungle 100 days. This guy told me he was the son of the piglin I'd killed years ago, and he'd spent his life training for revenge. There was some nether brick in the wall, which turned out to be a spawner. All the striders in here were freezing, so I thought I could do them a favor and help them back into the lava. Go now, be free. Your whole life awaits. Oh. Not exactly the outcome I was aiming for. I remembered spotting a bastion when I'd first entered the chicken nether portal, and it wasn't long before I found it. I rained down arrows on the local population minding their own business, and then checked the chests. They were not very good. By the time I made it back home, it was already day 77. I'd acquired a respectable 41 levels, which drained faster than my bank account. The maxed out gear was almost within reach. I just needed another 40 levels. I headed to the sheep pen and realized Muhammad and Catherine had somehow managed to start a family. I mean, congratulations, but like, what? How? Why? My crop harvesting powers were stronger than ever, and I bred the sheep yet again. Because I'm a terrible owner and have no idea what I'm doing, one of the chickens managed to escape, so he had to be dealt with. Here you go, Catherine. Do you even eat food? With some 1 AM villager trading that definitely violates some kind of employee safety law, I finally had enough XP to make a perfect chestplate. Good evening, Stingray. I sheared the sheep one last time and then headed into the nether, as it was finally time to mine for ancient debris. I found a piece on my way down. even if I did end up incinerating myself. Things were going decently, although I kept running into basalt deltas and lava spills every 2 minutes. Weirdly enough, I ended up stumbling into an abandoned nether mineshaft. I found a chest containing a frying pan, and this is easily the best thing any mod creator has ever added. I think the funniest part is that it does the same amount of damage as a diamond sword. I'm not really sure what the actual point of the nether mineshaft is, since there's no ores to mine down here besides quartz. I returned to the tunnels, and it wasn't long before I'd ran out of beds. Wanna guess how much debris I got? 7? 12? 15? I got 3 pieces, and one of them was the one I found right at the start. Get out of the elevator, Stingray, I'm not in the mood. But I brightened up when I learned you can put sharpness on the frying pan. I'd be mining some quartz while searching for debris, and finally had enough levels to make a perfect pair of boots. I began my morning by harvesting some cabbages, and managed to feed the chickens without breaking them free. I bred the sheep again, because I really need to get my wool supplies up. In order to make this special armor that I've been talking about, I need 8 netherite ingots instead of the usual 4. That's 32 ancient debris. While I waited for the sheep to regrow their wool, I began some illegal deforestation. Some legal deforestation in the village. I want to drink one of those bad omen 5 potions I got from the asylum and do a raid here at some point. Hold on, is that sheep trying to break the rest out? I was able to acquire a perfect pig. I went to rob the sheep of their wool, and that is a very weird looking sheep. I spent the rest of the night AFKing at the bottom of the trading hall so that by morning the sheep had regrown their wool. I returned to the nether, praying that my patience would be rewarded. I say patience like I hadn't spent the entire time I was AFK ordering dinner on Uber Eats. Thankfully, this time things went a million times better. I ended up leaving the mines with 20 ancient debris, which puts us well over halfway towards our goal. My axe was kinda weak from all the tree chopping I'd put it through, so I fixed it up with some quartz. I was down to 1 golden carrot, so I used my considerable wealth to stock back up. I actually had 24 netherite scraps total, since I'd found one in that first bastion I raided. This is pretty good progress. But we need to get stronger. I had a few levels spare and used them to make a passable bow. It's not exactly a weapon of mass destruction, but it's not terrible by any means. Tell your friends about the legendary frying pan samurai. Well, actually you can't, because I've just killed you, but that's besides the point. The reason I was yet again in the nether wasn't to do more debris mining, it was to collect enderpearls. You see, the plan is to first take down the ender dragon, then the wither, and then use the beacon from the wither to destroy a max level raid. It was a lovely sunny day back in the overworld, and it was even lovelier when I deleted this stingray. I crafted the Eyes of Ender and set out to find the stronghold. I quickly realized I should have crafted more, since they kept getting stuck in the trees and becoming impossible to find. Night fell, but I pushed on. I couldn't sleep since that would reset my spawn point, and then once I killed the Ender Dragon, I'd be all the way back at spawn instead of in the treehouse. By the time day 84 rolled around, I was down to just 12 eyes, so if I lost a couple more, I probably wouldn't be able to activate the portal. Fortunately, it wasn't long before the eyes started nosediving into the ground. I broke the golden rule of Minecraft and got exactly what I deserved. I continued digging, and within a minute, I was inside the stronghold. I found the library, and it had some amazing enchanted books. The second chest was even better. Sometimes the portal can take a solid year to track down, but luckily I found this one pretty quickly. The silverfish tried challenging me, but I've grown far past the point of them being any kind of threat. I lit the portal and then logged off because it was like 5 a.m. But after some sleep, I was ready to destroy this dragon. I'm not gonna lie, we've all seen the Ender Dragon fight 1,000 times, so I'm not gonna make you watch it all. I spammed her with my bow and bonked her over the head with a frying pan to finish up the fight. I took more damage trying to 1v3 some Endermen with the pan than I did the entire dragon fight. I scooped up all the XP, and unfortunately, Insight doesn't seem to work on it, although that makes sense given how OP it would be. I grabbed the egg and made my way through the gateway. and made my way through the gateway. For some reason, all the locals were really mad and started jumping off the edge. I thought I'd lend a hand. I saw some parasite spider looking thing and made sure to wipe it off the face of the earth. I knew finding a city was going to be a long and painful journey when even max render distance didn't produce any results. I discovered an end version of the desert temple, which was guarded by endermites. The chest room was actually way more dangerous, with every chest rigged up to TNT. The loot was amazing though. Diamonds, a diamond backpack, a god apple, and even a magnet upgrade for a backpack. Although, as I would quickly learn, the magnet upgrade is more like a downgrade since anything you throw away gets sucked right back into your inventory. I decided to detach the upgrade. I came across a crashed end ship, and while it didn't have an elytra, it had some decent loot. This diamond greatsword was insane. I mean, look at the size of this thing. Eventually, I managed to find a city, and even though it didn't deserve the word city in any name, shape, or form, it did have a ship. With the wings finally in my possession, all I had to do now was find a gateway to return home. This was actually somehow harder than finding the city. I spent ages flying and purling through the endless expanse of islands. It was a relief to finally find a gateway, regardless of whatever's happening on my screen right now. I made it back to the main end island and jumped into the fountain. Here it is. The end poem. Just kidding, we're not reading that. I had 66 levels and intended to use them to make the best sword possible. And I'm out of levels again. Hey chickens, did you miss me? I doubt it, to be honest. I scammed the villagers like usual and added mending to my elytra. The sugarcane farm I planted ages ago was coming in clutch, as I had plenty of paper to make rockets. By far, one of the best moments in any Minecraft world is the first takeoff. I had more than enough chickens at this point, so I collected the feather tax. I felt kinda bad, but it had to be done. All that was left now was to get the remaining 8 pieces of ancient debris. While I was in the Nether, I found this guy chilling in the lava and wondered if I could stand on him. The answer's no. I wanted to start a brand new mine, so I dug down and broke into the old one. It's fine, we'll just improvise. I had a stack of TNT from all the different temples we raided, as well as plenty of wool and wood for beds. I was determined to make this the final ancient debris trip. I also took the opportunity to mine plenty of quartz, since I needed a lot of levels to max out my sword. I ended up managing to find 14 ancient debris, which was way better than what I was anticipating. I smelted the debris, forged the ingots, and with both the feathers from my dead parrot that I didn't even name, and the feathers of the chicken family I had just extinguished, I created 4 featherite ingots. The armor I'd been working towards for so long was finally here. I also made a blazerite ingot for my sword, but forgot I needed to use a vanilla netherite ingot on it first. Not only does featherite reduce fall damage and allow you to triple jump, it also allows you to walk on water. Tell me that's not the coolest thing you've ever seen in this game. I then took to the Nether as I needed one last netherite ingot, which I intended to steal. I found a bastion and realized I had a long way to go before I mastered my new powers. I had a really fair battle with the piglins in which I first rained arrows down on them and then attacked them with my god sword from out of reach. Sadly, the loot was nothing but karma. I spotted another of these weird vulture things and finally got my revenge. There was another variant of a vanilla structure, this time being a soul sand jungle temple. Yeah, the loot was about what I expected. I saw a piglin outpost, and I could do this the stealthy way, or I could use my maxed out gear to its full potential. Take a wild guess which option I picked. I did all that for an onion crate? I found a ship guarded by wither skeletons, and it had not one, but 2 netherite ingots. There was also a pair of netherite boots that were utter garbage. They had curse of binding, curse of vanishing, curse of existing. It wasn't pretty. I had the blazerite ingot on me, so I maxed out my sword there and then. Yes, I did all of this for 7% increased fire damage. Is that a waste of time? I mean, yes, but It's cool, okay? It's cool. Look at my sword, it's cool. On my way back, I found a treasure bastion, which I was gonna be stealing from. I did a 1v3 winner takes all against the piglin brutes, and I won. So I took everything. Well, that was fun. Bye, guys. Good luck with the funeral costs. I was running severely low on rockets and made it back to the portal with just 3 to spare. I had plenty of gunpowder, but practically no paper. Fortunately, I discovered I could chop logs and use their bark to make paper, which actually makes a lot of sense. The next step was going to be making the village raid friendly. If you've ever done a raid before, you'll know that the AI can be funky sometimes. Mix that in with a village full of trees and bushes and holes to get stuck in, and it would be a nightmare to play. Sure, my solutions weren't pretty, but they were a lot better than having to spend 30 minutes hunting for that one random pillager who gets lost in a cave and stops you from progressing. I wasn't sure if there was actually anyone still alive in the village, which meant I would have to use one of mine as bait. I picked Belva because her name is fun to say, and as we were leaving, Brandon was like, "Where are you taking my 15th child?" "Don't worry about it, Brandon. I'm just going to use her to draw in an army about 10 times the size of our current population." I needed to keep Belva safe or I'd lose the raid, so I was going to have to build her a prison, bunker. I reinforced the frame with obsidian and even gave her a nice sunroof. I did realize there were a few citizens around, but I couldn't be bothered to move them into the bunker, so Belva gets to keep it all for herself. Day 93, I gazed out over the village, which was definitely looking a little worse for wear. I returned to the Nether as I needed to get the remaining 2 wither skulls. I kid you not, I got a skull from the first wither skeleton I killed. Naturally, that meant the other one took absolutely ages, but eventually I had it in my possession. Although I ran out of rockets on my way back, which means we're gonna have to walk. Do you think Pokemon Go works in the Nether? After a lot of complaining and walking and more complaining, I made it back home. After a quick power nap, I was ready to fight this 3-headed eldritch demon. It would be a battle known the world over. It would be nothing but the titanic forces of good versus evil. Hold on, one second, guys. Genuinely, I feel so bad for the Bedrock players out there, because the Java Wither is just so hilariously easy. I literally moved less than a meter and still won the fight. I found a cave centipede like the one that had nearly ended the playthrough on day 2 and took my revenge. Also killed this stingray because I hate them. Back up on the surface, I crafted the beacon and started piling my absurd wealth in the village. I chose Resistance 2 for the beacon power, since it would give me the best chance at surviving the attacks of the maxed out raid mobs. I then spent the night adding leaves to the tree branches that I've been too lazy to add leaves to when I first built them. Day 95 was a very special day. Why? Because I'm building a monument to me. Unlike certain aspects of this world, such as the villager breeder or Brandon, this thing looked amazing. Ah, just look at that handsome man. This is the kind of village improvement I can get behind. I then dumped all of the time I could spare into clearing as much space in the village as possible. I would only have one shot at doing the max level raid, as if I failed, I wouldn't be able to restart and still finish in time for day 100. Day 99, I stood atop my beacon and chugged the Bad Omen 5 potion. The town erupted in chaos as raiders swarmed in from the trees. You know this is serious when the Ant Nation joins in. All manner of enemies came to battle, including full diamond pillagers, baby creepers, wait, what? And literal knights. As the waves drew on, things started getting out of hand. Without the Resistance 2 beacon and Leech 4 sword, I would have been absolutely demolished. By far, one of the most annoying mobs was the Illusioner, since as far as I could tell, there was no way to distinguish the real one from the fakes. One of the enemies dropped an item that gave me the powers of an evoker. This is awesome. The raiders even stooped to trying to kill Muhammad and Catherine, but I wasn't letting that happen. Day 100 had arrived and the battle raged on. I must have cracked half my ribs here, but it's fine. I'll walk it off. Slowly but surely, the numbers started to thin. The raiders launched one final, desperate attack with all the forces they had left, but it wasn't enough. I used every ability in my arsenal to keep them at bay, with 100 days of Minecraft having led to this moment. I took down the final Illusioner and became the hero of the village. Aside from imprisoning the entire villager population in terrible conditions and forcing them to work for me, effectively negating any kind of hero status, I'd survived 100 days in a jungle-only world. You know what, Stingray? I think we can be friends after all.